And I think that's all. It says recording, so that's a good sign. Yeah. Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. Podcast with me, Billy. I am the big cheese and proprietor of Scottish Wrestling Network. Still, it's still available. It's still out there and still got content somehow. I'm joined this time with the Super Wrestling Entertainment System himself, the Gear of War. What monikers have you got?
That's it.
That's it. Okay, cool.
It's fine. The duality of me.
Cool. It's Kevin Williams.
Oh, you're wearing my t-shirt, Billy.
I am wearing your t-shirt. Yes.
Good lad.
It's got a bit of wear and tear now. It's got some holes. But
it's pretty old. I do have a new one, which I'm ripping the new letters.
Yeah. Probably my dog's decided to play with a squeaky toy right at the second. Right. Yeah, you do have merch. We'll get to that near the end. We were doing a roundup. So thank you for joining us. So thank you for this is episode 3. It's gone well so far. It really has.
I've really enjoyed the previous two because I've got a lot of time and respect for both of the guys that have been on, and I've enjoyed listening to their stories. So
been good. Well, this is a bit of a different one because I've actually met you. I've actually stayed at your house.
You have.
Oh, your flat, yes.
You have. So, that was a night.
that was definitely a night. I think I dressed up as Hulk Hogan at one point. It was a very interesting night. But let's speak about wrestling stuff because this is what this podcast is about. We'll go for the obvious questions first. How did you get started? What drove you to enjoying this weird world of wrestling?
The first thing I need to talk about is my dad. He's sadly no longer with us. 2004, he passed, and wrestling was our thing. It was absolutely our thing. When we first started watching wrestling, probably about mid-90s, it used to be a full family thing. Like, we'd get round, we'd watch on Sky Saturday morning, Saturday afternoons, we'd watch. You know, I can remember that, like, I had this discussion with Mike on his podcast about, you know, early wrestling memories, and I can only really vividly remember Survivor Series with Bret Hart and Bob Backlund with the towel incident.
94.
That's the only one I can remember, like, being everyone round, because we were absolutely, that's the beauty of old wrestling. We were so angry with the finish that Owen convinced, you know, the mum to throw the towel in. But right about that time, yeah, like we would all watch it. And the more time got on, it just became a me and my dad thing, and I really cherished that. And then we got rid of Sky for like a number of years, and then 99 Royal Rumble, that's when we got it back. And then it's like we never stopped watching wrestling. And obviously we're older now, and I'm watching, you know, Stone Cold, and there's beer and middle fingers and all of that stuff. And, you know, that's when it started to be like, man, that would be really cool to do that. It would be really cool to try and do some of that. Because, I mean, all the way throughout school, even like high school, like I would do a number of essays on wanting to be a wrestler. I'm sure my mum has an essay that I did about, you know, being a wrestler, wanting to move to America to do it all, sort of thing. So it's always been in the back of my mind. And then again, like most people, we all grew up in the Attitude Era. We grew up in the era of, you know, DX and The Rock and, you know, the ministry. I love the ministry. Like, Undertaker's ministry theme is hands down one of my favorite wrestling themes ever. That and Austin's heel music.
2001
amazing, amazing. That's something for the viewers and the listeners to really chime in on, as their favorite wrestling tunes. You know, it was roughly about that time that I started working. You know, former as a leisure attendant, and I met one of my good friends, Fraser Kelly. We instantly had this bond for wrestling, and we attended a show at the Rothes Halls, a venue that I have wrestled. I've had the privilege of wrestling in many, many times now, and it was one of the kind of touring brands from England. I can't remember the name of it. Could have been Allstate. It was Aurig Williams. So whatever brand they were running as. And we attended that show and had such people as, like, you know, a very early, I think Jack Jester, Grogan, Wolfgang, who was almost Spinner McKenzie. That match actually finished on a knee drop. And I later found out, Barry told me that he couldn't be bothered kicking out because he was almost Spinner. And I don't know the ins and outs of that, but I'd always found that hilarious because we thought that, you know, we were still young and naive at the time, and we thought that, you know, that was the finish, and, you know, wow, that was a bold move to end a match on. During halftime, we just hounded the ring announcer, who we later found out was Aurig Williams. And then he sent us he wrote down the email address for a training school in Glasgow. That was us. That was on a drive through to Glasgow, 12-hour training session, pretty much doing bumps. And then we were working both on poolside the next day on the Sunday, and we could barely move. Like I've always said, if anyone was in trouble in that swimming pool, they were on their own because we weren't doing anything. We were not in the even. We shouldn't have gone to work, really, but that's just what it was. It was just the introduction to see if we would go back, and we always intended on doing that. We always intended on going back, but a subsequent 2 weeks later, we found out about the WFL Wrestling Action Academy, which had its very humble beginnings in a school, you know, like the school huts.
Yeah, I think I know
what you mean, yeah. The school huts that they describe as like a temporary classroom, but they're up for years.
I'm on board with that now.
Yeah, it was one of those 6x6 judo mats, and that was it. And I will, to this day, value that bit of training because it wasn't basic by any means, but in the terms of being able to use a space effectively, because if you didn't bump on those judo mats, you were bumping on, you know, laminate flooring. So you had to, you know what you were doing and where you were going at all times. So that early training was probably invaluable to me. And it was the people like, you know, Taylor Bryden, Sarah Marie Taylor, another couple of people who aren't around just now. I'm trying to think of the early W3L crop that are still around, and I think it's just us three. I really don't want to offend anyone, but I can't think of anyone else. Well, I suppose Ewan, but he wasn't around during the school hut days, really. But yeah, although of that early W3L crop, I'd say us three are still alive and kicking, really. And that was it. That was me off to the races, really. That was me hooked. That was me properly
in it for life, kind of thing.
Yeah, I don't want to say obsessed, but like I couldn't imagine doing anything else, and I couldn't imagine doing anything differently back then. I mean, like I do have an old gimmick that I don't want to say I regret, but at the time I didn't have a problem with it because I got to wrestle. Yeah, like back then there was like three promotions if you were lucky, and at the time I started one, and then two when Mike started up again. The opportunity just to wrestle, I didn't really care. I was too naive to really care what I was doing. In hindsight, probably should have made a bit more effort. But that's the lesson that you learn, and that's the lesson that, you know, kind of makes you a better performer, and it has made me a better coach because it proved to me what you should be teaching your students to strive towards, not just being happy with what they're given, if that makes any sense.
Oh yeah, I mean, I think for any gimmick, I'm guessing from an outsider perspective, you've got to at least have a bit of yourself in there as well. You can't just be thrown a costume and going, this is you,
yeah,
go do it. You've got to have a little bit of input yourself. So that 12-hour session, do you remember who was training you?
That was Jack Jester and, I feel horrible for not knowing this. He's not around anymore as far as I'm aware.
That's fine. You will be offended if you forget. So that's all
right. It really upsets me because he was a nice guy and he was around during like the early ICW days. That's really, I'm going to have to ask Fraser that. But like people that were there were like Lionheart was there. He was really, again, Adrian was Adrian and there'll never be another one like him. And we actually got a break when he was deciding to show us, you know, how he clotheslined, which was a godsend because we were dying at the time. And, you know, it was really interesting to see. Drew was there. Drew actually was part of the car that kind of showed us where we were. We were kind of lost at a petrol station. The car came to meet us. He was in the passenger seat. I can't say who was driving. And we looked over and there's Drew just flipping us off. And we're like, well, that must be them.
And that's our WWE champion now.
It is.
For flipping you off at a petrol station to now exactly. Holding one of the biggest titles in the world. That's just
exactly.
It's a strange thing. So W3L, which is a company that you're really a mainstay in. You've held two of the three titles you can
yep. hold. One away from the Grand Slam.
One away, because of course the Breakout Championship is for people who haven't held titles.
Yep. So that's viable for me.
So you've been around a long time. Mm-hmm. I don't want to say you're old, but you've been around for a while.
I am. Like everyone probably will who gets to watch this will see the quarantine beard that's going on. There's a lot of salt and pepper in this. I've kind of made a decision not to get it touched until I can get into a barber, which is happening next week because that's allowed now. But I just wanted to see how crazy this I'd say it's impressive.
But, I tried to grow one.
Evidence. But,
yeah. Well, it did. It got a fair way. And then my wife was just like, no. So, I mean, I'm working from home. It doesn't really matter. No one's seeing me anyway. But
yeah
it was coming to the point where she's going, I can't look at you anymore. I'm going to have to trim that. And
yep.
I went, yeah, you can do the hair. That's fine. There's not a lot of it. And then suddenly, before I knew it, there was clippers here. And that was it. It was gone. It was a sad day for everyone.
You could have been attacked in the night. So
This is that. True. Yeah. So we'll talk about W3L then. So you've tag team champion with Jason Reed. Am I right? Mm-hmm. Think of that. And also, we're jumping around. I don't have any notes, as you can see. I'm not looking That's anywhere. Okay. So how's your journey in W3L? I mean, I said you've been there from pretty much the start of the relaunch. Would that be right?
Really? Yeah.
Any memories, any favourite memories, any favourite opponents, favourite matches?
Again, I probably should have had a bit more of a think about this. The beauty about working for Mike is I'd say it's different to most promotions just now because, you know, when you work for Mike, you're working, if that makes any sense. It's not like there's not storylines and there's not, you know, things to think about, but you know, most of the time it's a case of, you know, you start in the morning, you load the van, you get everything ready, you're travelling to the venue, setting up the ring, getting all that kind of thing sorted, and you're working, the match you're working is for the benefit of the card, not just for yourself, which is a really bone of contention with a lot of people, but for me, just I can't fathom, you know, being in the opener and deciding I'm going to have, you know, a five-star classic with the person that's on because that doesn't benefit anyone else. And Mike's always done shows like that. They're very family, you've been to them, like they're very family-friendly, meat and potatoes, very, you know, by the numbers of, you know, how a crowd needs to be treated, needs to react to what's going on. I would suggest to anyone to look out promotions like that because that's how you really, really learn how to work an audience. because most audiences are just your kind of run-of-the-mill people that have seen a poster, they've seen a flyer, they've wanted to take their kids.
Yeah, I can definitely attest to that for the Elgin ones anyway. I remember for the first book, I've been to them since 2012, I've went every year they come to Elgin. And for the first maybe 3 years or so, before I really started doing the website, I knew how the show was going to be. It was going to be first match, second match, the baddie from the first match, tags the guy in the second match, tag team match main event. And it was simple. I knew it was going to happen. I still enjoyed it because I'm watching wrestling. Yeah. I really don't care. Yeah. It was just I wanted to watch wrestling. Yeah. I did find it funny though, when I started doing the website properly, it changed. And I thought, you get, because I knew what was going to happen, and I was watching it going, oh, this is totally brand new. This is, which is great for me because I had to write about it. But
there comes a time when, you know, like, you need to realize that, you know, you might have repeat customers, you might have repeat people, so you do need to change up a bit.
But well, at least one constant stayed the same, and that's the Bulgarian Baker. So that's
Bulgarian Baker, a man after my own heart, and you know, he's worth every single penny it takes to get him over here on a yearly basis. I don't know what he's going to be doing just now. I don't know if he's been like furloughed. I don't know if Bulgaria has. I don't know what the situation is in Bulgaria with COVID. I don't know what the baking industry has suffered during COVID. He's not been in touch, so I genuinely hope that he's doing okay.
And there's a lot of dough at stake as well when he's not be able to come over and work.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah. Anyway, right. So we're talking about maybe the matches.
So like favorite matches, I could probably put it down to more favorite opponents, because sometimes, especially in W3L, like you get the opportunity to kind of work with some of the same people a lot of the time. And again, like my favorite opponent of all time is really the very good Mr. UNG Mackie, because, and I'm not the only one to say this, he is absolutely so easy to work with. Whoever he works with, he will adapt to that person and he will get a fantastic match out of them. And sometimes you'll get a fantastic match out of him. It's not solely down to Ewan, you know, as talented as he is. It's like the matches we've had, you know, I'd say 8 times out of 10, we would absolutely just, you know, just do exactly what we needed to do and we'd both come back really happy with what we've done. And again, Ewan's one of these people that has evolved and is ever changing, and he just gets it. I'm sure you would agree that he's just,
well, he's actually my dad's favorite wrestler. He's
your dad's favorite wrestler.
My dad's been to W3L and UPW shows, and he is officially my dad's favorite wrestler. So that's quite high praise for someone who's just coming around going, well, I'll take the kids. Not me. Although I am the kid, but my nephews and that were coming, and it was our cousins. But he was like that Ewan. I like that Ewan. That's fine.
That Ewan. Good.
Put that on a t-shirt.
In terms of other WFL people, I mean, Joey Legend was surreal to be working him for the W3L title. It was so interesting to plan that out with him, because of, I mean, again, Mike's psychology is one of the kind of key things you'll get from training at W3L. And my psychology is very set, but there's adaptions that can get made to whoever you're wrestling. So obviously he was the vet. So he's, you know, you tell me what to do, Mr. Legend. And it was very different, and it was a welcome different to plan that out with him. So many false finishes. I'm glad that, you know, I actually put in the work to get my cardio up for that match. We did one spot where it was the you know, the Kurt Angle run up top rope belly, I think the remedy that was on is going on, is the DVD's being worked on just now. And it'll be out soon, but hopefully if people can get to watch it, you will be able to see me, because it's not, I don't go to the top rope very often unless I'm getting thrown off it, point in case. But you can see me climbing the top rope, looking up probably asking my dad, like, please let this be okay. But, you know, I'm here. It was fine. And again, it was just a really enjoyable match. And he's just such a nice guy.
So chill. I had the opportunity to drive him when he was working for Rock and Wrestle up here.
Okay.
Because I'm up this way anyway, I was strung in. I was begging to help. I was like, I've got a car, so I'll drive him. So that was fine. Yeah. That was my job. However, my car broke down in Keith on the way. And it would only go 30 miles an hour in third gear. That was the only speed it would go. I still drove Keith to Aberdeen to go get him. Told him. He was like, that's fine. Didn't speak about wrestling for the next 3 hours as I drove him back all the way to Inverness in this car, only going 30 miles an hour. And he was just... He didn't speak about wrestling. He spoke about musicals. He spoke about comics. He spoke about everything. He was just... I think if it was anyone else, I would have just sat there panicking for that 3 hours. But he was just like, that's fine. It just happens, kind of thing. I mean, this guy's seen... he's probably seen some stuff and things traveling. I think a very slow journey to Inverness is the least of his worries. Yes. So I'm looking forward to seeing that because I do like watching Joe Legend. Of course, I enjoy your matches, of course. So it seems like a good combination. So we've got Joe as our one. Anyone else that springs to mind?
I think Jason Reed was obviously tagging, and then the subsequent matches that we would have towards the end of our pairing, as it were, we had a great match in Grangemouth, I think. And again, like, Jason's always been destined for more, and I'm so happy for where he is and where he's positioned. And I'm just happy to have been a part of his early development. He was very keen to, you know, ask questions, and, you know, your dog's having a great time just now, isn't he?
I know. At least it's better than sneezing. We had sneezing in the first episode, so.
But Jason Reed, and obviously we have to mention the absolute legend that is Johnny Lyons.
Of course. I wonder when his name was going to pop up.
Absolutely. I mean, again, same as Ewan. There was a time where, back in early WrestleZone days, where we would do nothing but wrestle because we'd do the birthday parties and all that kind of thing, and we wouldn't need much in terms of planning time. We'd just go out and do, you know, we'd just kind of look at each other and this would happen and that would happen, and I'd be sat in the corner in a certain way and he'd know. I can't say that just now. Like, we did have matches towards the tail end of his run, where we kind of challenged ourselves to do different things, but I think that chemistry was kind of lost by the time that we hadn't worked together for so long. But again, same as Ewan, like, it's very difficult to have a bad match with Ewan, with Stuart. I think, again, everyone that I've worked with in W3L, I can't remember really there being anyone I've come back from having my match, because again, like, the character I do now, obviously the Super Wrestling Entertainment System, it is the fun side of me turned up to 12. Most people say 11, but for me it's 12. It's just everything I love about life and wrestling just merged into the two. Most recently, I've incorporated a lot more of the gaming aspect of it, and you'll see it on Wrestling Showdown, my match with Ryan Rude, which is, again, my favourite match this year. I introduced the Yoshi spot, where any referee in the country now is fair game. If I bring out a Yoshi egg, I will ride them like a dinosaur. And again, COVID has just stalled so much. I had so much plans for every other match in WCL this year to have something gaming related, but I mean, that's all in the back burner. That's all for when we get back. So yeah, that would kind of bookend most of the kind of matches and guys I really enjoyed working with. And that's not to say that anyone else I haven't enjoyed working with. It's just those guys stand out to me.
I'm just going to pause a moment and go get that squeaky toy, because yeah. I think that seems like a good spot just to moment. I'm just going to keep recording thoughts, but fine. So you can plug whatever you want in the meantime while I'll wait for a couple of seconds.
Okay. So ladies and gentlemen, while Billy's away, you'll notice it is backwards because of technology. But this lovely, lovely Kevin Williams Mario-esque design hat, which can be emblazoned on any garment you can want. You're still back, but I'm going to keep plugging.
I've now confiscated comment, the toy.
Just send me a message on my Facebook and Kevin Williams Facebook page, and you can get your very own Kevin Williams merch. Okay, you're back.
Perfect, that's fine. She's now looking at me like I'm the worst person in the world. But
you are the worst person in the world.
She'll find another squeaky toy. There's a million of them in this house. So that seemed to nicely end that little chapter. Are you still wrestling Showdown Champion? I might remember that.
I am still wrestling Showdown Champion. It's difficult to remember such a thing, because I haven't defended it since that match with Ryan Roode. Oh no, Craig Stevens. Craig Stevens was my last defence. You know, there's so many people that are like, well, surely you should be relinquishing. I can't even say the word. Say it for me.
Relinquishing. I can't say it either.
You know, I haven't defended it in 30 days, but I think since COVID hit, the wrestling world could be put on pause.
Absolutely. I love that belt. It's like, it's the Attitude Era IC title, isn't it?
It's beautiful. I mean, again, going back to when I was a teenager, like that IC belt was something that stood out to me, and I always had that dream of holding it, and having a belt that looks very similar to it is very surreal. And again, like having any title put on you is just an honor and a privilege. And I like to make sure that, you know, I'm represent, because it's for the. It's called the Showdown title, so there's a whole, you know, web series dedicated just to that championship. So it's an honor and a privilege to represent that program as its champion. So,
which we feature every week on swnscotland.wordpress.com, which is from the W3L network, of course, which you can check on YouTube. Plugs. So you're speaking about your video game character. That kind of gets us neatly onto your, we will speak about more wrestling stuff in a minute, but we'll speak about Press Start Gaming. Seems like a good way to go there. So it's very clear that you love your video games. So how did that go from loving video games to starting Press Start Gaming?
Well, I mean, I've always been a collector. I'd say in the past 6 years, subsequent 6 years, that's really gotten more. Again, when I first started dating my wife, I only really had two consoles. Again, it was my surviving N64 and my Xbox 360. And then when I moved in with her, she had her PlayStation 2 and her Wii. We set all these up on our cabinet, and I just started like buying PS2 games, and then, you know, subsequently that collection started to grow. I got a Super Nintendo off eBay. It's disgusting to put it mildly, because it's one of those ones that's just all yellow. It's a thing that happened with, you know, a lot of the N64s. It's just the way the plastic is aged. And then that grew and grew, and then I just started to really look into, you know, collecting in the wild started becoming more fun than just going on eBay or going to CEX. So that became something that we did. We'd go to Errol Market, we'd go to places down south, we visited London, we went to like a games market down there. It was great. And then again, I just started thinking, I was like, there's nothing like that up here. There's nothing apart from CEX or the odd, you know, boot sale. There was nothing to really go to for the avid collector to get these things out in the wild. And, you know, I'd been helping out, and you know, I'd been around wrestling shows and promoting wrestling shows for so long. I was like, well, I've got the knowledge to put an event on. I've got the knowledge to get word out there's an event, get people in. I'm certainly capable of getting people together, as in, you know, sellers from all over the country to this one place to, you know, put on the first retro gaming market, which we did in March of 2018. And it was one of the most kind of nerve-wracking and exhilarating days of my life, because again, I've not put on a rest. I hadn't put on a wrestling show at that point. And we were probably 45 minutes from doors opening, and the queue was down the street, and there was nothing like that, because that's a thing that I put on. I put that out there that this was happening. I promoted it and people turned up. That was incredible to me. So, and again, all of the sellers did really, really well during that day. And that was, again, I didn't take much money off them. I charged them for the table, really, which sorted the venue. That was really it. I don't do press start to make money. I don't. And, you know, I thought at the time it was important that people turn up and don't just do like a lap of the tables and go away. So I used, you know, the collection I had to put out, you know, your classic consoles. I put out an N64, Super Nintendo, a PlayStation, Mega Drive, you know, stuff like that. And, you know, I put on like the Mario Kart tournaments, which was amazing. I made my own trophies at that point. I bought a couple of joysticks and spray painted them gold, you know, Games Master style. People really, really dug that. So that led to me doing a kids retro gaming day, which was just the same as what we had for the consoles being out, but bigger. So that led to me buying so many televisions. Like, my spare room looked like the end scene in The Matrix 2. Again, that snowballed to us doing a retro day for adults. More markets, it just snowballed from there. And now we're sitting with, you know, our retro gaming lounge, which is in the Boomerang Centre in Dundee, you know, with 16 setups, and it's a private little gaming arcade for people to book out. Obviously we're not operating just now due to COVID, but we hope to be up soon. We have plans for another. I did a gaming festival, which was probably the most nerve-wracking experience of my life, because my wife was in the hospital with, you know, an impending child, because she was threatening to arrive early, and she did. But, you know, that event still had to have someone there while she was in hospital, so I had to, you know, and I had to go and man the door and make sure everything was running, and then the second I could, I left to go to the hospital during like one of the biggest events I've ever ran. But that's part and parcel with running events. But I can't say that I regret anything that Press Start has afforded me, and I just can't wait to get back to it. I mean, Press Start has allowed me to be part of the greater gaming events industry. I've got a great partnership with a company called Fraggers, which runs down south. They run gaming events, same as me, but on a just massive scale. Gary Kirby, that runs that, is an absolute genius. He's such an inspiration to me on how such things need to run. And you know, I've helped him with the retro sections at his events that he's been hired in to do, like Resonate in Glasgow, and one up in Aberdeen. What's the name of it? It's the big building. Wrestling's been there. It looks like the Avengers building.
God, I've been to Aberdeen. I don't remember anything about Aberdeen. I know where you're speaking about. I can actually see it, but yeah, I can't tell you what it is.
I can't remember the name of it either, because it was just a blur for me. Yeah. It was during a time where I was doing that event, and on the train up to Aberdeen, I got the phone call that the lounge had been broken into.
Jesus.
So I was just panicking that all of my consoles and TVs were away, but happily enough, it was fine. But so yeah, the whole travel up there was a bit of a blur, so I can't remember much about it. But no, Press Start Gaming Scotland, find us on Facebook. We are absolutely 100% ready for the second that we can start doing gaming events again. We will be hitting the ground running.
Sounds like a good way to go into our questions that came in through the Twitter as you're speaking about gaming. I'm just going to get them in front of me. We got two from
a whole two.
I'm super good at social media. so we've got two from the username at Mr. Spocksbeard. As many will probably know for his wrestling exploits as well. But I think these are two great questions. First being, who would win in a fight between Mario and Sonic?
Now, I did read that this morning, and I've had some time to go into that. And again, you know, taking out, you know, such examples like Smash Brothers, because then you can find out for real. But I think I have to give it to Sonic. You know, the blue blur can move at speeds, you know, that Mario can't, and I just can't see an Italian plumber surviving, you know, a spin dash attack. So I would have to give it to Sonic. And there's also been like a YouTube series of swapping over Sonic and Mario in the games that they represent, and Mario is screwed the first loop-de-loop that he gets to. So that just says it all.
And the other question was, I'll read it out verbatim. Big words. What DLC would you consider to expand your moveset in 2021?
Oh, well, I mean, that ties into the thing I said earlier about the plans I had for, you know, various things that I wanted to do, and I'm going to keep them to myself because I will unleash them upon the W3L network when we get back. But I mean, definitely, I had plans to do things from Sonic, and I had plans to do things from Gears of War. And again, I don't want to say too much because I just think it's very unique what I've got planned, and I hope I've got the right opponent that sells it well, because, you know, wrestling's daft and these things just add to a show. And I can't wait to unleash my gaming badness on the ring.
Will it be as daft as the Ba-Bomb?
The Ba-Bomb? Dafter.
Oh, God. I remember seeing the Ba-Bomb. I think you were against Glenn Dunbar in Dundee.
Glenn Dunbar.
And yep. Just the panic that everyone had when the Ba-Bomb came out, which was just, that's what wrestling should be. That's it. Everyone just going crazy for it.
That's not to say that the Ba-Bomb, I mean, I come out to the ring with that question mark box, and you don't know what's in that box. Just saying.
I mean, it was a very scary time, because that was the time I was down and stayed at yours, so I had that Ba-Bomb in my car for a very long time, because I had to wait a month before I came back down again, as you left it in my car. So we'll briefly touch on your time in Dundee, because again, it's in our place you've wrestled a lot. Exactly. Holding titles. Mm-hmm. Must be what, two tag team titles with Luke Xavier.
Yep.
At the time, yep. Many may know as Luke Aldridge now.
Yep.
And were you the inaugural? And when I'm with Nathan Reynolds, and you were the inaugural hardcore champion. Am I right?
I am. I think. I mean that whole time leading up to the hardcore title was just. It was really special, because I mean all of the guys in that match. Let me jog my memory. There was Jace Jackson, Eddie Devine, Chris James, KG Nitro, and Spike Tierney. We all put our two cents into that, and we created something really, really special. in that match, because again, a hardcore title is very easy to cheapen, I think. Again, just the addition of a 24/7 rule cheapens it in some ways. I'm glad in some ways that it wasn't around while I was champion. Not that those kind of antics aren't entertaining. They definitely are. Again, I remember the Crash Holly skit when he's in the soft play area with I think it's Mosh and Thrasher that attack him, and he goes on the Flying Fox and gives him a hurricanrana off the Flying Fox, and I thought that's just
fun time USA, yeah.
Fun time USA.
I'm just jumping in on that. Yeah, it's the 24/7 thing works if it's managed. I had to keep a track of this for the website, and it was an absolute nightmare because nobody knew what was happening. And anyone I contacted, they were like, I think so-and-so. I was like, I don't need think, I need who wins. It was a nightmare. What were your positive experiences from your time, Dundee?
Positive. Again, just like the great matches and great opponents that I've had. I mean, again, you know, I've got a fairly what's the word to describe it? I've had many tag team partners. I'm a very open individual when it comes to, you know, my tag team relationships. The beginning of Dead Cell is something I will never ever forget, because Nathan wasn't in limbo in terms of wrestling. He just wasn't doing as much because of, you know, family commitments, all that kind of thing. So he kind of stopped working for W3L for a spell, because when you do W3L shows, it's a long commitment out of your day. But you know, the opportunity arose where I needed a tag team partner. I messaged him. He actually said no to start with because it was date night. And then 10 minutes later, he said, no, my wife says yes. And then all I sent him was a gif of, you know, the 300 nod to what's his name? Gerard Butler, before he, you know, lists Sparta, kicks the guy. And I've always said that it was it's Leanne that, you know, gave the nod of approval for us just to come together. And at the time, it wasn't, we hadn't decided on the name Dead Cell, we hadn't decided that we were going to be a proper tag team, but you know, just me and Nate, like we'd never worked together even in that capacity up to that point. We just clicked as a tag team straight away. You know, busting out this tag move, that tag move. So it just became a thing. And then he'd always wanted to have a group called the Dead Cell. He always imagined it being like the kind of elite of the East. But it just morphed into us as a tag team. And then we were off to the races, as they say. We just ran roughshod with, like, I talk about the fun side of me, the gamer side of me, but the Gear of War side of me is another side that I love to present. And I always put it out there in my CV as something that is absolutely marketable, because it's a more rough and tumble version of me. I will go out there, I will absolutely smash everyone. And that's what we did. We, to the point where the Dundee fans turned us face, and we didn't change a thing we did. We still went out there and beat every single person in front of us up. And it was just one of the best runs of my life, having that person who's been my friend for so long, still is to this day, obviously. And we were just the tag team. There was no other tag team in Dundee quite like me and Nate. So that's definitely one of the highlights. And again, that's not to say that my other tag team partners, apart from the first one, let's negate that one. But tagging with Luke was an experience, because Luke was, he'll admit it himself, quite green in a lot of ways. But again, we evolved together. We evolved to to again work on tag team wrestling. Is that the ice cream van?
That's the ice cream van. Yeah.
Yes.
I think every noise that could happen has happened during this. At least it's not,
I'm not allowed carbs, so I can't have a 99.
Oh, no. Don't hate it. 99s don't cost 99 anymore. I remember the day they used to cost 99p.
What a revelation. But yeah, so yeah, like the tag team scene in Dundee, I'd like to think has a great deal of thanks to show my way, because I was a part of probably every good tag team angle that was going on. That's really all I can say. It was the tag team run and the hardcore run was incredible, and I'll forever be grateful for the opportunity that was afforded to me to do that. Another highlight of my hardcore run was the Christmas show that we did, where I got to implement Home Alone-esque weapons such as a snow shovel, sledge, an iron, matchbox cars, and obviously Lego. But an interesting story about that was I actually went round the town, and again, this was like Christmas time, places were shutting really kind of early, and I picked up the iron from TJ Hughes, the kind of department store, and I only used it once in the match where I threw it at KG Nitro's face. I put it back in the box and took it back and got my money back.
Speaking of your tag team run, if I mind right, the first time I saw you wrestle at all was in Perth, Jewers Hall. Mm-hmm. Steel cage, four-way.
Yes.
What was it like wrestling inside, especially that steel cage that had everyone around you holding the thing up?
Okay. That steel cage was, oh God, it was basically scaffolding with bells and whistles. We've seen it, you know, the practice run of putting it up, and we just thought, my God, what is, like, because, like, I mean, you could go underneath it. It wasn't like we were enclosed in a cage. You could go underneath the thing, and that was it. So we just wondered how it would really work. I mean, it's bittersweet, that match, because we had obviously massive legends, Roddy Piper, Tatanka, Chavo Guerrero, and
Ted.
Obviously Ted. Yeah. How could I forget Ted? We'd planned for that match to be first after the interval, because we had a band on that was going to take half an hour. So that was going to be the time that the ring was going to go up, the cage was going to go up. And then after the match, that was when, two sides of that could come down fairly quickly. It was the other two that was a bit more problematic, but that was the time that Piper's Pit was going to go on. And then, you know, the main event was going to happen with Tatanka versus the champion at the time. And things happened where, you know, the veterans we had on had changed everything so that, you know, Piper's Pit and then the championship match happened side by side. So that was what it was. And the cage match went on last, which I didn't agree with. None of the guys agreed with, because it took an absolute age for the cage to go up. That's why it was planned during the interval. So it was probably pushing about 9:30 before we started. Bearing in mind this is in Perth, a lot of people had come from Dundee, people were maybe having to get trains home.
I drove home that night, so I was kind of hoping for an early finish as much as possible. Yeah.
It was what it was, but, you know, it would have been better the way it had happened, but it didn't, so that's that. Actually, wrestling inside it was a blast. It was so fun. because of the stipulations that we had, like, and the way that the match worked out, I never actually had to climb the thing, which was great. But it was hilarious selling something on the ground, watching Luke climbing and catching his gear on, you know, a stray bit of metal. But the best part of that match was taking the elbow off Randy off the top, because
it was you that took it. Because I remember the elbow. I just can't remember who took it.
And Randy's elbow is like safe as houses, and I didn't think for a second that it wasn't going to be. And it was the first time I ever employed my Devon Dudley oversell to anything. But that, again, I remember that match was really fun. I just really wish it would have happened when it happened, because it would have just, again, for me, like, cards need to have a structure the same as a match needs to have a structure, and that match just did not fit last. It didn't. So everything apart from that was great about that match.
So I feel like I've kept you long enough, so I can't not speak about your current endeavour, which is being the man with the pen, the pencil, the commissioner of Fair City Wrestling in Perth. So how did that get started? And we'll just go for a really broad question. What's plans? What's your plans coming up when the shows return?
It would always been kind of discussions between myself and John about, you know, how would we do this? How would we do that? Is there places that we could potentially, you know, do something? And at the time, you know, Perth had kind of been left alone in a lot of ways. And I don't mean in terms of, you know, like the last time something had been run. There was a time where places in Dundee weren't available for whatever reason, and they had run shows in the Tulloch Institute, but at the time we just felt that it wasn't done right in terms of the potential that Perth has in terms of promoting, in terms of, you know, putting on the best that we can do. And again, through discussions with, you know, the people that run Dundee, you know, we borrowed that ring. Well, we rented that ring, and we, you know, put on our first show. And again, it's always been my goal, as, you know, the man that holds a pencil, to give something to the guys in Dundee that, you know, give me their time for training. You know, guys such as Tommy Cross, Spike Tierney, Zach Leon. Those guys deserve more than they can be afforded. Well, they could have been afforded at the time, in terms of working with other people. But they got the chance to work with, you know, people like Aspen Faith, all of that, through Fair City. And that's always been the goal with Fair City Wrestling, is to bring a different and varied card each and every time, with new people and people that don't get a fair shake of the stick. People like Cav, who is tremendous and an asset to any given card. And at the time, he was just being brutally underused for the hard work that he was putting in. So that's really how we got started. And by good grace, we've got the hat trick on Scottish Wrestling Network for match of the month for the months that we've ran, and we owe that to the people that have voted for us, and we are so grateful, and we're just bitterly gutted that we couldn't end the year with like a perfect game, as it were, because we had so much planned. The match between Massimo and Valhalla was one I was absolutely chomping for. Not to say it won't happen, maybe, I don't know, but we'll see. There's definitely plans for the people that have missed out on what we had planned to reap the benefits of when we start up again. I suppose that leads into future plans.
It does. It bleeds quite nicely. Yeah, I don't know whether it's just because we've been on for so long, it's starting to go No, you're going to have to start to pay for this, but for Zoom. But I can still hear you perfectly, so it's all good.
Okay.
There was a cover photo put up on the Facebook page for Fair State Wrestling that the plans are that you'll be coming to Dundee in 2021. Yep. So expanding a little bit. Is that just the general plan, just kind of Tayside and then
expansion. Beyond? Any business needs to expand. Any business needs to have a five-year goal. Any business needs to branch out, as it were. And there are many opportunities in Dundee that we feel have been wasted, that have been burned, for the lack of a better term, and we are not going to let them go to waste. It was always John's plan to look into that, and it just feels like the right time to plant the seeds and get things going for when we can, you know, do such things. So that's all I'll say, really.
Okay.
But obviously we do have the FCW training school. That's we're still working on the actual name of the training school, but that's definitely something that's in the works as well. We need somewhere. We have acquired a wrestling ring, something that Jotun's should be incredibly proud of, from the hard work that he's put in, and we have probably every facet of operating a training facility worked on. Given the situation when it comes to wrestling just now, just in terms of paperwork, policies, legislation, all of it, we've got probably every facet of that worked out. We just need our bricks and mortar to get that sorted, and then again we'll be off to the races. So it's very exciting for FCW.
Excellent. I think just because he'll moan otherwise, do you want to say something nice about John?
Something nice about John?
He will ask. I know as soon as this goes up, the first tweet will be him going, did Kevin say something nice about me? So I think we should just get that in here.
John is the absolute most straightforward person I think I've ever met. You'll meet people in wrestling who will never give you a straight answer about things because of a number of reasons, and it just doesn't help anyone, really. I've always been about open communication. I've always been about being part of a team that has the goal in mind, as opposed to working the people that we're supposed to be working towards a goal. Apart from being, you know, an incredibly funny human being, he's just the most straightforward, to the point, this is what I want to do, so I'm going to do it kind of person. And I think that really bodes well for the future of FCW, as well as the team that we've got behind us, because we've got an incredible team behind us, people that don't even have any modicum of interest in wrestling, but they've got such a passion for the HR and behind the scenes part of it. I'm so happy that the team that we've got together will be able to have, you know, every facet of the business covered. But again, we've got John at the head of the table, so it's definitely a privilege to be working for him.
Excellent. All right, I think I've kept you long enough now, so we're going to do a little bit of a wrap up. I'm sure I'll let you do your plugs again, because I'm sure you did them when I was going to confiscate this dog's spooky toy. Plug yourself. Where can we find you? What do you want to just everything?
For Press Start Gaming Scotland, simply type that into Facebook. That's the only thing I really use for Press Start Gaming Scotland. It should be one of the things that pops up immediately. Find about all our events there. For me, I think Instagram is g.o._KevWilliams. Facebook, it is just Kev Williams. You should find me, or you'll find a realtor from America, because I keep getting messages about, you know, houses on the East Coast, and I'm like, I don't know. I just ignore that. And Twitter, is Kev Williams SWES, which is a Super Wrestling Entertainment System, for a bit of clarity on that. I think that's it. If you contact me on any of that, you will be able to see the amazing merch items that DD6 Designs has designed for me, including the various colours of this Mario themed logo. I have a Sonic themed logo, a very unique Sonic themed logo, it's just really cool to get that side of my character out onto these bits of merch. So anyone wants to hit me up, please do so.
Excellent. Perfect. Well, thank you for joining us. I'm going to stop the recording now. Let's see if I can do this successfully this time.